How y'all doing? Everybody have a good day today? Did you freeze? It was cold at 5 o'clock this morning. Alrighty, well, if y'all will stand, let's sing page 330, Shall We Gather at the River?
Stand by.
Cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Soul at the Savior's feet, plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Oh, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Oh, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory.
Amen. Good evening to everyone. It's good to see y'all. You got your Bibles? Y'all turn over to Romans chapter 7, if you will. What a day it's been. We had a great memorial service this morning, and praise God for that. Has anybody heard how Miss Jackie did in her surgery? Yes, ma'am? Did very well. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Back in her room now. Amen. Praise God. Well, last week we left off in verse 6, and what I want to do is I want to read and then do a little bit of review, a little background, and of course jump into what we're looking at tonight. So, let's look at verse 6 in chapter 7. It says, "But now we are delivered from the law." We talked about what that word delivered means. And it says that being dead wherein we were held, in other words, having died to that which we were bound to, that we should serve in newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. Again, what we saw was that Paul was very clear that the letter of the law no longer was their master. And when they were in sin, yes, but now in Christ, no longer. Christ is their master now, and He's our master if we're in Him. We also talked about the privilege of grace and the abuse of grace that many people make even today. Many people argue that they don't have to do certain things because they're under grace. Many people argue that they're free to do certain things because they're under grace, not under the law. Things like, well, I don't have to go to church every time because it's not, you know, I don't have to. God, you know, we're not under the law, we're under grace. I don't have to give my time. I don't have to give my talent. I don't have to give my treasures to God, because it's not about the law anymore. It's about grace. And they use that excuse of grace for so many things. And I shared last week that if we just spend a small amount of time in the teachings of Jesus Christ, we would see that that reveals a great errancy in their belief. And Jesus very clearly taught the spirit of the law of grace. And it revealed a higher standard. And that's what we saw last week, that grace had a higher standard than what the letter of the law carried. And we saw that the philosophy that people carry around using grace as an excuse was fallible by its very nature. Because if the standard of the law was a higher standard, then why did Christ die? And that's what we asked last week. And besides that, we know that the law didn't die for our sins, didn't die in our place, and Christ did. So how much more, under grace, are we a debtor to Christ to serve Him than we were under the law? And so the next time we are encouraged this last week, the next time someone says, or the next time we feel like that we have the liberty to say, well, I'm under grace, so I don't have to do this, may we remind them, or may we be reminded ourselves, that we're not to claim grace as an excuse to do what we want to. We're not to use that. It's not okay to please our flesh and claim grace as the reason. And I would encourage you to remind them, and encourage us all to remind ourselves, if we ever get to that place, to remember what price was paid to give us that freedom. What debt we owe to the grace of God. How it was purchased. It was purchased with the blood of Jesus Christ. And so we continue our study and we look at what Paul is going to do tonight. And he's going to explain more of the place of the law and the purpose of it. We're also going to see this great struggle. Many of you may be familiar with Romans chapter 7 and know it's where Paul reveals this great struggle within himself. And he's going to reveal that there's two natures, and we know that, but they're at war with each other. And so he's going to walk us through this. We'll walk through that together and see what God has for us. So let's pray, and we'll get right into it. Father, we come before you. We thank you for this day. God, I thank you for just the blessings you've given us so far today. We thank you for allowing us to serve you. We thank you for men that we remembered today, like Eugene Bowman, and that were faithful to you in every way that they could be until their last breath was drawn. And God, I pray that all of us would live lives like that, devoted to you, until our last breath, committed, faithful in all areas of our life, not using grace, not using anything as an excuse to slack off. And I pray that we would just be used up for your kingdom, Lord, because when it's all over, when our life is over on this earth, all that's going to matter is how much we gave for the cause of your kingdom. And I just pray that you would bless tonight's message and just speak to our hearts, and we'll praise you for what you do. In Jesus' name, amen. So chapter 7, verse 7. So Paul now asks the question. He says, so what shall we say then? Well, what's the conclusion of this matter? Is the law sin? Listen to what he says. God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. See, Paul has painted up to this point this gloomy picture of the law. He's given us this illustration that the law has seemingly suppressed. The law has not only done that, but it's indicted him and the whole human race. And so he asked the question, is the law bad? Is the law sin? Is the law itself evil? And his declaration is absolutely not. God forbid. The law is not. And he very clearly explains that had the law not said, thou shalt not covet, he wouldn't have known that lust was a sin. That covetousness that was in his heart, that desire for things that he had that were wrong, was sin. Now, I want to talk about that word covet for a second, because the truth is that covet in itself is not a bad word. The Greek word is epithemio, and that simply means this. I'm going to read the definition to you. It means to set the heart upon, to long for, rightfully or otherwise, wrongfully. It means to covet, desire. It means, first of all, to turn upon a thing, to have desire for, to long for, to desire. So that in itself isn't bad. Number two, though, it says to lust after, covet of those who seek things forbidden. So covet is both good and bad, depending on one thing. And that's the object. In a right sense, to covet God's blessings. In a right sense, to covet God's presence. In a right sense, to covet prayers of others. Those are good things to covet. Those are good objects. To covet God Himself, to desire, to long after, to turn to and focus our affections on God is a good thing. But again, it carries a negative connotation as well. And again, the difference is the object of our covetousness. Many people say, well, what would be some of those negative things? Very clearly, we can look in the Ten Commandments and see the things that we shouldn't covet. One of the things is our neighbor's possessions. One of the things is our neighbor's wife. But also to desire something that is above the Lord, to covet, to long, to place something of value, and therefore set our affection, set our life upon something that we place above the Lord in our life. Sometimes people covet power, and they put that above the Lord. Sometimes people covet money. Again, the same thing. All negative states of covetousness, among many others. But Paul is declaring that the law revealed that his desires for these ungodly things, that his desire for these earthly, these temporal, these sinful things, were in fact just that. They were sin. And it does the same thing for us. But he goes on, look at verse 8. He says this, "But sin, taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence. For without the law, sin was dead." That's the power of the Word of God. Once it's revealed, then it begins to pierce to the very dividing asunder of soul and spirit. The Word of God pierces down. If we'll let it in, it pierces down and it separates what's sin and what's not sin. But it's a matter of whether we'll let it do that in our life. It reveals because it's light. And it reveals true darkness within our sinful nature, our old man. And sin indeed becomes exceeding sinful, as we'll see in just a second. But Paul said that it revealed in him, and it produced, it worked, it showed, it manifested all manner of evil, all kinds of bad, sinful desires. And that word concupiscence is the very essence of that. It's simply, the Greek word is epithemia, not epithemio, epithemia, and it is the negative use of desire. It's negative coveting only, sinful in nature. So when the commandment, when the law was revealed to Paul, when he read it, when he saw it, it exposed all kinds of sinful desires, all kinds of evil desires in his heart. And he makes the statement at the end of verse 8, he says this, "And without the law, sin was dead." Without the law, sin was dead. Isn't that true though? Think about this. While we have consciences before we're saved, at times before Christ, we know, you know, relative to our life, what right and wrong is. But it's not until we look into the Word of God and we see that transgressing the law is considered sin in God's eyes, and we see the standard in which God has placed, then and only then we can understand that when we look at ourselves, compared with the standard of the law, we see many offenses. There's a whole lot of wrong in us. And again, many people claim grace. Well, I'm just we've talked about this right now, just a sinner saved by grace. That shouldn't be something that we parade around to give us excuse to live a life of sin. That should be a glory and an honor of what God has done in our life, the grace He's shown us in spite of our sinful condition. Again, not a license to sin or to walk in the flesh. But that's what Paul is explaining. The law revealed I was worse off than I thought I was. That's what he's saying. The law was revealed to me, and it revealed I don't just covet a little bit, I covet a lot. I have wrong desires a lot. I have a lot of sin in my life. The more I look into God's Word, the more it reveals this to me in my life. And to better describe his state, he said that, again, sin was not even a thought before the law was revealed to him. And now it's exceeding sinful. He continues to explain the state in this next few verses. Look in verse 9. He says, For I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived, and I died. We've already seen in Romans chapter 3, it very clearly says that we've all sinned, and we've fallen short of the glory of God. We've seen in Romans chapter 5 that Christ died while we were in that state, while we were yet sinners. And we saw that sin is passed, and death is passed upon all men because of Adam's transgression. And Paul is saying at one point, he came to the realization of that truth. At one point, the law was revealed to him, the truth was revealed to him, and when that happened, he died. Sin became evident. Oh, I'm in that boat too, he said. It was evident in his life. He knew, therefore, at that point in time, the reality and the consequence of sin, which of course is death. Romans 6:23. But verse 10, he says, and the commandment which was ordained to life, that's why God gave it, I found to be unto death. For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me, and by it slew me. So the commandment, which was to, again, result in life, resulted in death in his own personal life. He realized when the commandment came, when the word of God was revealed to him, I'm dying. And that was a serious thing for him to get. Because up to that point, he didn't really understand or grasp how important or how detrimental sin was, and the effects of sin, or the consequence of sin. Because he was dead indeed to the trespasses, in trespasses and sin. And that's the truth for all of men. And Paul was walking us through this reality right here. The commandments of God are good, and they're life. That's they come from God. Everything that comes from above is good. But to the sinner, to the lost soul, to those family members that we have, maybe someone sitting here tonight, they're a death sentence. They declare the punishment of transgressions, which is, again, is death. And that's what Paul is illustrating. He's holding up the law. Here it is. Here's the law. It's good. This thing that's from God, it's good. But it's revealed sin, and it's revealed a curse. This amazing thing, this law, it's good. There's a struggle. It's good. It's from God, but it reveals bad. It reveals sin. It reveals death. So I have to ask the question. I believe that Paul's rhetorically speaking here. He says, verse 12, wherefore the law is holy and the commandment holy and just and good. Verse 13, was then that which is good made death unto me? He's in a struggle here. The law is good, but revealed bad. So is this law that is good become the cause of death? Is this the problem? Is the law the problem? Is the law the cause of sin? Is the law the cause of evil? Is the law the cause of bad in our life? Is it the law's fault that we'll die? His answer, look next in verse 13. God forbid. May it never be. No way. The law does not bring death. The law does not kill us. The law does not cause us to sin. The law is not bad in itself. So if the law revealed sin, and he realized that he's a sinner and he's going to die because of the demand for sin is death, and the law is good, then he asks the question, who's the bad guy then? Who is the bad guy? If the law is revealing all this bad, and it's supposed to be good from above, but it's showing me all this bad, and it pronounced me dead as a sinner, there's got to be a bad guy in this situation. There's got to be a culprit that I can blame, that I can point to and say, this is the enemy. This is the problem. And look what he says further on in verse 13. But sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good. Again, what is good? The law. That sin by the commandment, by the law, might become exceeding sinful. He said, sin is the culprit. Sin is what works death. Sin is the problem in all of our lives. He's already revealed that. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. Christ died for the ungodly. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. All those things. Sin is the enemy. Sin is the culprit that brings death. And again, he points out, and sin is revealed by that which is good, the law. But the amazing thing about the law of God is it doesn't reveal just a sin. It reveals all sin. And it reveals the gravity of sin. So He's now identified the players in his life. He's identified the law. It's good. It reveals sin, and that's not good. Sin is the cause of death, so sin is the problem. Sin is the culprit in this struggle. And in this identification, it's allowed him to gain a little perspective. Even now, as the struggle that he's going to share with us, that he faces in his life. Sin is that evil. Law reveals sin. It pronounces judgment of sin, which is death. Verse 14, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. So he puts another aspect on this. This is quite interesting. The law is not only good, but the law is spiritual. And so what's the big deal about that? Because it's God's law. The law is spiritual. It's good. It's right. We should cleave to it. We should rejoice in it because it does reveal our sin. It does reveal our insufficiency. All those things. And Paul's realizing, or he's exposing this in this letter to the Romans, he's saying God's law is spiritual and it's revealed that I am a sinner. I'm fleshly. So here it is. Here's this new aspect. He says, now I see it's a spiritual battle versus a fleshly battle. He said, I've identified the law, I've identified sin. It's not the law that's bad, it's sin that's bad. And so the law is good, it's spiritual. You can see him working through this, and I'm carnal, sold under sin. I'm a sinner, I'm going to die. And so now I see that there's a war going on here. There's a spiritual side and there's a carnal side, there's a fleshly side. And he's going to be revealing in the next few verses this battle that rages within his body. The Apostle Paul, this great battle that's raging within his life right now, spirit and flesh. Look what he says in verse 15. He says, for that which I do, I allow not. I allow not. What does that mean? What is he saying here? You know what he's saying? I don't really understand my own actions. I don't get what's going on in my body, he's saying. I don't understand how this battle's going on in my life. I've identified the players. Yes, I've seen law, I've seen sin, I've seen good, I've seen evil. I see spiritual and I see fleshly, but in my life, I'm trying to work this out because I don't understand my own actions. I don't get why I make the choices that I make. Has anybody ever felt like that? I don't understand. I don't get why I struggle like this. I don't understand why I just said that. I shouldn't have said that. I don't understand why I just acted like that in front of them. I don't understand why that person, they just simply cut me off. I don't know why I had to honk the horn and shake my fist and curse under my breath. I don't know why I had to do those things. Oh, how did he know those things? But we all get to that place where we say, why did I just say that? Why did I just do that? Why did I just act like that? And that's what Paul's saying. For that which I do, I allow, and I have no idea why I do sometimes. I've identified the players, law, sin, spiritual, fleshly. I see all those things. But I still don't understand why I have this struggle. And he goes on and explains himself. And in explaining himself, he explains us to the T as well. Listen to what he says. He says, for what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. Uh-huh. He's saying, what I want to do, I don't do. And what I hate in my life, I end up doing that. The Apostle Paul. Well, why is he revealing this? We're going to see in just a second. Look at verse 16. He says, if then I do, if I'm doing those things which I would not, then I myself, I'm consenting that the law indeed is good. So even as an apostle, even as this person now, I've seen the law, I know sin, I see spiritual, I see fleshly, and I don't understand my own actions, and I'm doing these things that I don't want to do, and by doing that, I am declaring, I'm testifying that the law is right, the law is good, and I'm wrong. He already said that. I'm carnal, sold under sin. Because by doing what I do, I'm agreeing with the law. Another revelation is revealed then. Look in verse 17, and here it is. Now then, so because of this, it's no more I that do it. Listen to what he says. But sin that dwelleth in me. Now, I want to say this, and I'll explain this more in just a second. But I've actually heard people blame sin. While yes, sin is the culprit, our flesh is at battle with our spirit. And that's what we're going to see in just a second. But there's a choice, and we'll see that. Many people say, it's just sin. Just sin. It is just sin. But we should not resign ourselves to that. Ever. We should not just say, well, I'm going to be this way because it's sin. And I'm still in the flesh. No, it's not a resignation. We'll see that in just a second. But he does identify, again, sin is the culprit that's inside of me still, that's causing me to do these things. And that's doing these things. Verse 18, for I know that in me, and he clarifies what he's talking about here. He says, that is in my flesh. So in this body, he says, I know that in me dwelleth no good thing. In and of myself, this fleshly person, there is nothing good about me, he says. Remember, he already declared he's carnal and sold under sin. He admitted that already. But he says this, look what he says, for to will is present with me. But how to perform that which is good, I find not. Again, in his fleshly person, in his flesh, he realizes, listen, there's nothing good in me. And I'm living this life, and there are desires to want to do God's will, but I can't identify the struggle. There's this desire in there I can't identify yet, but because in my body, in my flesh, in myself, it doesn't want to do anything but sin. It just wants to sin. Sin is working in my members, and it's driving me crazy because I don't understand my own actions. Look at what he says. But how to perform that which is good, I find not. So he's struggling with his flesh. He's struggling in his whole body, his whole person. He can't get what's going on. The law has revealed what's right. The law has done that. What's sin? Here is sin. Here, these desires that you have in your heart for these other things, that's called sin because it's covetousness. The law is pointed out in his life. And he says, in my own flesh, I don't have the ability to carry out what's good and what's right. I only have the ability to do what's wrong and sin in my own self. In verse 19, he says, for the good that I would, I do not. Again, speaking as a person, as a carnal, fleshly person, he's saying, the good that I would, I do not, but the evil, which I would not, that I do. The sin that I don't want to do, I continue doing. That's what he just said. The sin that has been revealed in my life that I say, no, I don't want to do that anymore. I still do it. It's a struggle. It's a battle. It's a fight. It's in my flesh and it's driving me crazy, he's saying. I can see Paul getting so frustrated. He's saying, why am I still battling these things? Why, when I look into God's Word and I read His pure Word and I see His perfect law, that things are revealed in me that are obviously sin. These desires, these thoughts, these actions that I do. Why is this still present in me? Why am I still struggling with this? And I can see Paul's frustration as he's crying out. He's saying, listen, the good that I would, I don't do. But the evil, which I don't want to do, I end up doing. And so I'm in this fight, I'm in this struggle, I'm in this warfare. And he goes on in verse 20. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin dwelleth in me. He's working this out. He's saying, here's another declaration in this discourse that he's given right here. He's saying, the root of his struggle is sin. His fleshly body is struggling because sin is present within his fleshly body. He's still in this earthly body, and he's saying, I don't understand why I do what I do, and he's working through this, and he's writing this discourse to these Romans, and he's explaining to them. He's talked about the law, he's talked about Christ, he's talked about grace, he's talked about the punishment of sin, he's talked about all these things, and he's revealing this reality to them. And now he's going to further that reality and how it even applies to us. And he says this, verse 21. So I find then a law. I have the struggle. I don't do what I want to do. I do what I don't want to do. I realize that it's sin inside of me. That's a struggle, but I don't get what's going on because I realize that sin is the cause, and there's something in me that don't want to sin, but there's something in me that does want to sin. What's going on with me? And so again, he reveals, he says, I find a law that when I would do good, evil's present with me. That's a reality, he says. Every time I want to do something that pleases God, there's still the presence of evil in my life. On this earth, I still face that struggle, he says. And I think that most of us can testify to that in our lives. Try to get committed to God and see if those temptations don't come. See if those battles and struggles don't come. Try to say, you know what, God, I'm going to devote myself to faithful prayer. And close your eyes and start trying to pray and see if thoughts don't start coming up. Distractions. Tomorrow, what am I supposed to do? And sinful thoughts and all these things just start coming in. And you're like, why am I doing this? I'm trying to do good. I'm trying to pray. I'm trying to do something that God wants me to do that I want to do inside. There's that desire inside. But at the same time, there's something playing against that. There's something that's battling against that in my life. And it's driving me crazy. He says, I found a law. I find a reality, a truth. Here's the truth. Here's a law that when I want to do good, evil is still present. And it drives me crazy. Because he goes on in verse 22 and he says, because, listen, I do want to do good. And I've realized who it is. He said, for I delight in the law of God after the inward man. Ah, the inward man that's renewed day by day by the Spirit of God. The inward man that was regenerated by the washing of the Holy Spirit. The inward man that was redeemed. The inward man, the soul, the spirit, the person that we are. But still, the flesh is still there. When I want to do inside, when I have these spiritual desires, when I have these desires to do good and do what God wants me to do, there's still evil there. You know what? I'd like to lead someone to the Lord. And we determine, you know what? I don't make the time. I say, I'm going to go Thursday night. And what happens? Boom, something comes up and it becomes a choice of maybe priority. Oh, I you know what? I want to do that. I know I need to share the gospel with people, but I really want to do this. Ah, when I would do good, evil is present with me. The battle of what God wants versus what our flesh pulls us to. Disobedience in God's word is sin. And we struggle in this life and we can't figure things out sometimes. And Paul's saying, listen, here's the reality. It's going to be present. This is a truth. When we want to do good, you can guarantee that there's still going to be evil pulling at you. Sin, that fleshly nature, trying to drag you away from doing what pleases God. The Apostle Paul himself struggled with that. He's saying, this is a reality. This is a truth. You're going to have this in your life. Again, remember a few verses back, he said that he knew within him his flesh dwelled no good things. No good thing. And now he's saying that he's delighting after the law of God, after the inward man. Again, revealing two different struggles or two different sides of the struggle. And yet this reveals another truth. Look at verse 23. He says, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. He said, here's the law, here's the truth. I want to do good, but when I want to do good, evil's present. And he goes on and he says, here's another law too. And it's warring against the law of my mind. It brings me into the captivity of the law of sin, which is in my members. So there's the war. That's what is revealed in verse 23. There's the law. There's the war. There's the battle. There's the struggle that he's been revealing. It's a battle of laws. It's a battle of truths. It's a battle of realities. Which the inward man, again, the spiritual man that's renewed in Christ desires to obey. It desires to obey the law of God, but there's this law of sin. It's hanging around in his flesh. And it kept him from doing right. And it drew him to sin. The same thing for us today. And then Paul is going to, in a present tense, say this in verse 24. Again, I see Paul at this point so frustrated. And maybe he was frustrated as he was even writing this, as the Spirit was inspiring him to write this. Maybe he was. Maybe this part of the parchment paper or whatever he was using there, it got a little indented a little more because he was frustrated. Maybe he was pounding his fist on the table there. He was writing and he was struggling. He was, it's driving me crazy. There's these things. There's a law. There's sin. There's evil. There's good. There's spiritual. There's fleshly. I want to do good. I don't do it. But at the same time, there's a part of me that doesn't want to do good. And every time that I desire to do good, evil is present in me. There's this struggle. Aha, here's the truth. That every time that I desire to do good, evil's present. And I realize that it's that inward man that's been renewed after Christ, the one that's been regenerated, the one that's been saved, that desires to please God. But at the same time, there's this law in my members, and it's obeying the law of sin. It's warring against the law of my mind, and there's a struggle going on in my life, and it's driving me crazy. And verse 24 says, "A wretched man that I am. I'm a wretched man. I shouldn't be struggling like this. I shouldn't be struggling. I'm renewed after the inward man. I'm redeemed. I'm a child of God. I'm under grace. I'm no longer under the law. I realize that I'm going to heaven when I die, but I still do wrong when I want to do good, when I want to do right. Oh, wretched man that I am. What's wrong with me?" I can see him throwing his arms up. "Why am I struggling like this?" Anybody ever felt like that? Amen. "I don't want to think those, I don't want to do those things. I don't want to act like that when somebody acts like that. I don't want to treat people like that. I don't want to do this." Because when I read God's word and it says to bless those that curse you and pray, inside of me, I want to do that. But my flesh says, no. They just attacked you. You attack them verbally. When I read that I'm supposed to lay down my life and submit my life and give my all and do these things, I long for that. Something inside of me is longing for that. I want to lay down my life. Inside of me, there's a part of me that says, "God, if you'll send me to the furthest parts of the world, I'll go wherever you want to go." But then all of a sudden, there's something inside my body, warring in my mind, saying, "You can't. You can't afford to do that. You can't. You don't have time. You don't have ability. You don't have strength. You don't have talent. You don't have anything necessary." It's warring against all these things our heart longs for inside the inward man, striving after. And then we've got this battle of the flesh in our life. And Paul is disgusted by it. And I want to say tonight, I've been there before, disgusted. I am so ready for that war to be over. I'm so ready for that battle to be over. What an amazing question that he asked. Look what he says. After he hollered out, "Oh, wretched man that I am," he says this: "Who's going to deliver me from this fleshly body of death? Who is going to deliver me?" What an amazing question, and at the same time, a self-revelation. He knew he didn't deserve what God had given him. He knew that he was saved by the grace of God. Yet he was not okay disobeying God. He was not okay giving into his flesh. And you know what? Shame on us if we are. Shame on me if I am. And if I'm okay realizing this battle in my life, that in my inward man, the one that's redeemed, I want to obey God, but I realize there's a struggle going on, and my flesh don't want to do that. My flesh doesn't want to obey God's word. Shame on me if I give in to that flesh. If I realize there's a struggle and I don't try. How many of you in here have ever desired to be who God wanted you to be only to find the struggle in your flesh to be that person. God, I want to desire you at all times. I want to be able to study your word. I want to be able to pray. I want to be able to witness to anybody I come in contact with. I want to be able to give. I want to be able to serve. I want my body to be used up. I want to be who you call me to be in your word. I want to do that thing. And then you find yourself struggling in your flesh to be that person. That's what Paul's declaring. And in desperation, he cries out with this question, who is going to deliver me from this? Who's going to save me from this fleshly body that obeys the law of sin? That fleshly body that keeps me, hinders me from fully obeying the law of God that the inward man desires and delights after. Who's going to save me from that? Who's going to deliver me from that man who keeps the struggle alive in me? Maybe he's thinking in his mind, what's my hope? What's my help? We could ask ourselves the same question. When I've got this struggle, I see it in my life. What's the answer? Who's the help? Where do I turn? What's the hope in my life? And look at verse 25. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's what the answer is. And so that's so simple. But listen, our hope, our help in this life to overcome sin, to mortify those members of the flesh that long to sin, our only hope to please God comes through our Lord Jesus Christ. So I need more. Here's the truth. We don't have to hopelessly, we don't have to helplessly struggle in this struggle that Paul's talking about, that we all have said, yes, we've struggled with that. We're struggling with that now. Again, this revelation of Paul isn't a resignation to just give up. It's not a resignation to a false truth. Well, we're all going to sin. Even the Apostle Paul struggled. He was saying right there that he did things that he didn't want to do, but hey, he was still apostle. God still used him. It's not we saw in his declaration, oh, wretched man that I am. Who's going to save me? Who's going to deliver me from this condition? Who's going to help me out of this? Who's going to deliver me from this body of this death? So it was a very big deal to Paul. He wasn't okay with it. And we shouldn't read this and say, if he struggled, then I'm okay if I struggle. No. It's a revelation that there's victory in Jesus Christ. That's what it is. That there's help through him and there's hope through him. And it's not just from the struggle in this life with sin. Not just in this life, but it's a complete deliverance. One day from this struggle altogether through him. Paul goes on with the rest of verse 25. He says this, look what he says. Here's the deal. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God. My inward man, I'm serving the law of God. But with the flesh, the law of sin. If we turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we'd see Paul writing to the Corinthians about their groaning to be unclothed from his sinful fleshly body, his earthly tabernacle, he calls it. And in his disdain and his desire, this groaning to be unclothed with this fleshly body, he's crying at the same time that he would be clothed upon with an immortal body. A body that's not touched with the temptations of this life. With a body that doesn't struggle with sin. He says, I groan, we earnestly groan, he says. That we would be unclothed with this earthly tabernacle and that we would be clothed with that heavenly building that's made of God. If we turn to Philippians chapter 1, we would see that he saw death as gain. He thought, man, what a victory it is one day when I get to get out of this fleshly body, that the struggle will be over. And remember, Paul faced shipwreck, he faced stoning, he faced imprisonment, he faced beating, he faced abandonment, he faced false accusations, he faced the worst that we could face in this life. And yet, He doesn't cry out. He embraces that persecution. He embraced that struggle. He says, you know what? It brings glory to God. That he said, that I may know him. That I may know his sufferings and the power of his resurrection. He said, you know what? If this is what I have to do is die daily, experience deadly moments in my life, stoning, fighting with the beast at Ephesus. If I have to do all these things in my life, you know what? Then it's just a little bit I can share in the sufferings of my Savior. He didn't cry out, who's going to deliver me from these persecutions? Who's going to deliver me from all these problems? No, he says, we're pressed on every side. We're pushed down, but we're not destroyed. But the one thing he cried out for help, the one thing that he was fed up with, the one thing that he was disgusted with, the one thing that he just cried out and said, who's going to save me from this? Was this battle with the flesh and spirit. And so it's a big thing. Paul saw that death was a victory. He says, for me to live is Christ, but die is gain. Man, if I could live my life and I lived in Christ and obeyed him and my life was a reflection of his light, if I live that life, that's the best thing I can do. But you know what? If I die, it's better. What an amazing perspective he had. Because he realized that to die meant that he would have freedom from the struggle and victory indeed. But in this revelation, it wasn't just that delivery in death from this struggle that he was calling out. He was calling out that we have victory even now. We have victory given to us through Jesus Christ. The key to this entire section, this entire discourse that we just went through, that Paul wrote to the Romans, is that our hope and our help is found now in Jesus Christ. Not only now, but whenever he calls us home as well, there's hope and there's help. It's not found in the law. It's not found in doing enough things to be good enough. It's not found in ourselves. It's only found in Jesus Christ. And the question that I have for us tonight, and Brother Turner, if you'll go ahead and come up here, is this: how much are we leaning on Jesus Christ? How much are we looking to him, turning to him for that help and that hope? For that deliverance in the struggle. I don't know about you, but I've already said this. I've been there. I'm still there. I can't stand it. I should have done this. I should have done that. I shouldn't have done this. I shouldn't have done that. Why am I still struggling like this? That is a real struggle. Our only hope and our only help in this struggle is to continually drive ourselves to Christ, continually turn to him for that hope. He's already given us the victory. The victory can be found over the flesh. The flesh can be mortified. That old nature can be suppressed and killed daily, but it's got to be a choice that we make. A choice to turn to him on a daily basis. Be disciplined no matter what. Even when those desires and those thoughts, and we're trying to pray, come in our head, God, help me, I'm having these thoughts while I'm trying to pray to you. Help me, God. I need your help. I'm trying to focus and my mind's going everywhere, every way. And I can't even talk to you without distraction. I can't even talk to you without these desires that I don't want in my heart and my life. I can't do these things. Then we have got to continually drive ourselves to him. And that leads to the next question. How diligently are we seeking his face? Do we face this struggle and then give up? Because I know I've been guilty of that before. Begin to pray, get into the prayer, and the next thing you know, here comes a distraction. Okay, just for a second, I'm going to... And the next thing you know, you never get back to it. We've got to diligently seek his face. We've got to passionately seek his face. And I think it boils down to another question. How much are we willing to yield to him? We've already seen that in Romans. Yield your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. I believe if we don't do that, I believe if we're not diligently seeking his face, if we're not willing to yield to him, if we're not willing to turn to him for the hope and help in this struggle, then I believe that we're going to lose this fight that Paul described. I believe that we're going to be living in defeat. I believe that we're going to be living a life of disobedience as a child of God. And we're not going to be receiving blessing like God wants to give us, but we're going to be receiving discipline and chastisement. That's not very fun. So why not tonight say, Lord, help me. I need help because I'm there where Paul was, a wretched man that I am. You're going to help me, God. You're going to deliver me. You're going to save me. You're going to help me in this fight. I have this struggle, and I don't want to struggle with it anymore. So I'm going to continually turn to you. I'm going to diligently turn to you. I'm going to be obedient. The inward man wants to obey. So when I see that obedience, I'm not going to let the flesh distract me. I'm not going to let the flesh pull me into sin. I'm going to go obediently. I'm going to go to you diligently. I'm going to seek after you with everything I have. And we'll find that help. We'll find that hope. There's no question in my mind. Because if you've ever experienced that victory in Christ for that, then you know it's real. I've experienced it. I know probably every person in here has experienced it. And that's the difference. God, help me. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. We thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you so much for your word. God, it reveals so much sin in my life. It reveals so much wrong, so much evil, so much shortcoming. Lord, we fall so short. But God, I do thank you. Lord, you've given us help. You've provided the victory already. You've delivered us from sin, from the punishment of sin. But we know that there's still a battle within our members. We know that we battle in the flesh. And so, God, I pray that we would be wise enough to heed your word, to see what you inspired the Apostle Paul to write. That we would turn to you, diligently seeking your face, knowing that you have delivered us, that our hope and our deliverance is going to be found in you on a daily basis. And so, God, I pray that we would be wise to turn to you. God, help us in our struggle. Help us to be obedient and follow after the Spirit, not after the flesh. I pray that you just help each person here tonight. We'll praise you for what you do. I ask and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll stand with us. Tonight, maybe say, God, help me to seek you more diligently. Praise God. We're going to continue praying for our this prayer list that we have. And what I'm going to do is we got four sections. And we'll just break into sections. We'll just change it up however the Lord leads each week. But I'm just going to give one prayer request to each elder. And so Brother Ricky, if you'll just take this. We just each got, Brother Turner's got two, but we each got a, just a topic that we want to pray about. Israel, our nation, the Supreme Court decision concerning homosexual marriage, Christians being who we're supposed to be. And so if y'all would just gather around and get in a circle in each little group, then we'll pray for these things.